Well, praise God, it's Memorial Day, and you're here at church. You are smart. You are kind. Amen. Well, last week we had Pastor Brenda from San Francisco with us, and we had a good service. Had lots of folks come up front and get a refilling, the Holy Ghost. Amen, that's good stuff. Amen. And then the week before that, all the ladies were in here getting filled up every night. A lot of jumping and happy going on. And how many know there's nothing wrong with that? Bless God, we should all be jumping and happy. But you know there's more to it than that. Amen. And so what I want to talk about today is the real purpose of being filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. Because you need to wonder, you know, what's the evidence? You know, like Pastor Brian was saying, what's the proof that you love God? Well, a part of it is that you tithe, you honor Him. But another part is you give Him your life and you do what He says, if you love me, obey me. Amen. And so I want to talk about that today. If you would, turn over to, well, you don't need to turn there. Well, you can. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Because I don't know about you, but if something happened in the Bible that's supposed to happen to the rest of us, I want the real deal. I don't want a part of it. I don't want a fake thing. I want the real deal. And when I got filled with the Holy Ghost, I got the real deal. Amen. And you can know you got the real deal because your life will change. Yes. You will never be the same. Amen. So 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 says this, "But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come, for men and women will be lovers of themselves." Lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers. This is sounding good, isn't it? Disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control. Does this sound familiar? Amen. Brutal despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. And I love verse 5, having a form of godliness, but denying its power. And from such people, turn away. That could cut off most of your friends. That might even cut you out. Amen. But how many know on the day of Pentecost, or just before that, Jesus said to the people, He said, you shall receive power. Amen? What did He say? He didn't say you'll receive tongues. He said you'll receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, we just thank You for Your presence in this place. We thank You for Your presence in each one of us who has given our lives to You, and we believe what You say. And Father, we thank You, Lord, that You have called us and anointed us for a time such as this to be world changers. Not to be sitting in the church on Sunday and then dead to You on the week, but alive all the time. And Father, I just thank You that we are doers of Your word and not hearers only. And we walk in the blessings that You have made for us. And we thank You for it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. So Jesus said you will receive power. Amen. After the Holy Ghost has come on you. And how many know there's a lot of personal benefits to being filled with the Holy Ghost? You know, when I got filled with the Holy Ghost, before I got filled, I was just like everybody else. I smoked, I drank, I cussed, I looked at the women, and I told lies and any other stupid thing I could think of. Y'all out there? But when I got born again and filled with the Holy Ghost, it didn't happen so much when I got born again, but when I got filled with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit began to talk to me and work on me about my lifestyle and about the things that were hindering me from walking full time with Him. How many know you can become a Christian but not really give place to God and not listen to Him to do the things you need to do to change your life? Y'all out there? And we grow up with insecurities, we grow up with fears, we grow up with anger, we grow up with all kinds of junk that hinders us from being who God called us to be. And we want attention and we want notification from everybody. And that detracts from what God has for us. And the world doesn't need more people that need more attention. The world doesn't need more people who are drama queens and kings. Come on. What the world needs is people who know who they are in Christ, know what they're here on the planet for, realize they've been empowered by God to do something better than just get along. Amen. And when Jesus says, you shall receive power, I don't think He said, you're going to receive power to sit in the pew on Sunday morning and then act like you want the rest of the week. I don't think He said, you're going to receive power so you can stay the way you are. I mean, if I received power to stay the way I am, all I needed was another beer. And I could stay the way I was. But when I got the power, the beer didn't hold much of my attention any longer because it was nothing compared to the power. Y'all out there. Amen. And so there are personal benefits to being filled with the Holy Spirit. And our lives should change as we walk in the blessings of God and adhere to the Word of God and become doers of the Word. How many know God doesn't bless everybody? The Bible says He blesses the doers, not just the hearers. And so a lot of times you get Christians that are wondering, why isn't God working? And the answer is, you don't do anything He tells you to do. You're not a doer of the Word, so you cannot walk in the blessings of God. Yeah, but I believe in Jesus. Well, that's just the first step. Now you got work to do. And don't nobody like work that affects them. I mean, everybody believes that, you know, people should be subordinate to other people, but they believe everybody should be subordinate to them. You do what I say. But God says, if you can't do what I say, you're not going to walk in the blessing. Amen? But God wants us to walk in the blessings, and He wants when somebody sees you, don't look around. When somebody sees you, He wants them to see Jesus. Amen. When they spend time with you, they should sense the presence of God. When they talk with you, they should hear wisdom from heaven. Well, how have I got to do that? You spend more time with God. Find out what the Word really says about being filled with the Holy Ghost and not just what you've heard. Amen. As you know, our lives, listen to, our lives are going to be touched or judged by the lives we touch for Jesus. If you don't ever get anybody saved, you never lead anybody to Jesus, you're not ever a part of people getting saved, it ain't going to be as much fun as you think it is if you make it to heaven. I want to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Because you did what I said to do, and you were where I wanted you to be. Amen? Amen. That was good. Acts chapter 2:4 says, and they were all talking about that night, the day of Pentecost, you know, And there's more to Pentecost than just tongues. It says they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And you and I need to speak with other tongues. We need to be blessed with the gift of tongues and interpretation and all that stuff to edify ourselves, to build ourselves up. Man, I'll tell you, every Sunday before I come to church, I take my prayer drive and I drive out the freeway towards Seaside or Tillamook, whichever way I feel like going. And I pray in the Holy Ghost. I get myself prepared to come because I don't want to show up here and all you get is me. You shouldn't want to go anyplace and have all the people around you get is you. Because I'm going to tell you, they don't need you. They need God. They need His anointing, His power, His blessing. They don't need your problems. But I got problems. Well, get saved. Get filled with the Holy Ghost, apply the word to your life, and get rid of your problems. But you don't understand. No, you don't understand. This works. The problem is you like your problems and the attention more than you like getting fixed. I mean, how many people like the attention of being sick so somebody can pat them on the head and say, oh, I'm so sorry you're sick. Oh, I love you anyway. I don't want to be sick just to get attention. Thank you. I don't need anything else to get attention. Y'all out there? What I want is to do what God put me on the planet to do. And that is to reach people with the truth of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ with healing and miracles and signs and wonders, whatever they need that will affect their mind to believe God. And if I have to change everything about me to do that, I'm going to change it. Y'all follow that? I grew up listening to my mother and my two aunts and my grandmother. Just everybody they met, they would sit around the coffee table later and talk about them, tear them to pieces. And I learned how to do that good. I don't even have to know you to tear you apart. But then I got saved, filled with the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit didn't think that was such a good idea. Amen. That I should judge people and tear them apart without even knowing it. And then especially the ones I did know. Because He thought I should do something to lead them to Jesus rather than just tear them apart. Y'all following this? And so what God wants from us is to be so filled with the Spirit of God that there's no more of us showing. So that if somebody comes up and cusses us out, we realize that person's hurting. And they need Jesus. And I'm here now, so I'm going to help them. And it's amazing to me in my short career as a Christian how demonstrating the love of God to somebody when they least expect it turns their hearts around. Y'all out there? It's easy to love somebody that loves you back. Even sinners do that. But when you love somebody that doesn't like you, and you demonstrate that love. How many times in the Bible did God say, be nice to your enemies. Give them water if they need water. Give them food if they need food. Be nice. That's not human nature. That's God nature. And you and I need to tap into that God nature. As for myself, I want to find out what God has for me to do, and I want to do that. And what I've found out is that in this whole Holy Ghost thing, the tongues is not the intended purpose. It's one of the tools to help us move to the intended purpose. But the intended purpose is, watch this, chapter 8 of Acts. Acts 8, verse 5. Watch this. This is talking about Philip, who was one of the disciples. He was with Jesus for three and a half years, and Jesus taught him how to act. Taught him what to do. And so he picked up what God had for him to do. Watch this. It says, verse 5, it says, then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ to them. And the multitudes with one accord heeded the things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many who were possessed, and many who were paralyzed and lame were healed. Y'all hearing this? And there was great joy in that city. Hallelujah. We had some great joy here last Sunday and last week. But you know, I don't know about you, but I've seen several revivals in our country in the last 37 years. And a revival to Americans seems to be for the Christians to get together and dance and be joyful. But I've yet to see a great revival where people actually begin getting saved by the thousands. We have this idea that the Holy Ghost is just about us getting praying in tongues and then getting together and we all laugh and have a good time. And there's nothing wrong with that. What I want you to understand today is there's more to it than that. You need to be filled up. You need to be full of joy. But don't stop there. Somebody out there is looking for somebody who really knows God, who can get them healed, delivered, set free. Philip was having such miracles that paralyzed people were being healed. That shouldn't be uncommon in your life. Y'all out there? See, we think, well, if Jesus was here, he would do something. He is here. Who's inside of you? Jesus. Jesus isn't coming down to do any more miracles. Can I tell you something? You're his miracle. You're his miracle doer on the planet. And we get so boggled in our heads with trash, we don't even ever get close to doing what God's called us to do. And it's no wonder the world's going the way it's going. What if people really met a Christian who knew they had been endued with power from on high by God and the Holy Ghost, that if your baby's sick, I can get him healed? You have that power. If you're born again, if you're filled with the Holy Ghost, you have that power. You need to realize it. You need to wake up to it. And you need to start doing something with it. Amen. I said amen. See, too many people have tongues as the goal. I've heard people say, I want that tongues thing. I want that tongue. No, you don't want the tongues thing. You want the Holy Ghost. You want the Holy Ghost thing. What happens is, and I watch this a lot, people get the tongues thing, and then they go back to being unfruitful Christians for the rest of their life. You get that tongues thing, and you get the power of God on the inside. I mean, think about it, the power of God on the inside, and you're sad? Are you freaking kidding me? You have God on the inside and you can't get happy? You are thinking on the wrong things. You're talking the wrong things. You're practicing the wrong things. You need to get your head out and into the Word of God and believe what the Bible says and do what the Bible says and get over yourself. Well, you don't understand. My family's just always been this way. Well, cut that family off and get a new one. Dear Lord, you don't need that family anymore. Amen. How many of you got born again? Well, guess what? You got a new family. That old family you grew up with ain't yours anymore. You can say hi to them. Most of you need to say bye. But you got a new family. And the new family is empowered to do what Jesus did on the planet. Right, Autumn? Instead of just wandering around, you know, what's the real purpose of Pentecost? For you to change the world. Now, Pastor, you're just getting excited today. We're just Christians. Well, if you're just a Christian, you made it that way. Because as far as God's concerned, a Christian literally means to be Christ-like and to be an imitator of Christ and do exactly what Christ did. That's what Christian means. Christ-like. Amen. And what did Jesus do with the disciples? He says, I'm leaving you, and I'm going to give you the same. You've been watching me, and I've been changing the world with the power of the Holy Spirit on the inside of me. He says, I'm going to leave, but I'm going to give you that same power to live on the inside of you so that you can continue my ministry on the world. Right. Amen? Right. He didn't say, I'm going to just leave you. He says, you shall receive power. Yes. I said, power. Yes. Everybody say, power.
Power.
Not tongues. Well, I got that tongue things, but I just don't know if I believe. I can. I don't know. You need to get the power.
Yeah.
Tongues is excellent. You need that. But that's a stepping stone to getting you to be where you're supposed to be. Are you out there?
Yeah.
So the real issue is that what do you believe should be accomplished in you when you get the power? That's the real issue. Do I get the power and then just go back to being me? Or do I get the power and become changed? Do I get the power and become a life changer? Or I still have the same problems and I still have the same thoughts. Well, tell the thoughts to go away. Did you ever tell your mind just to shut up?
Yes.
Some of y'all need to do that on a basis. Just say, shut up. I mean, some of y'all, your mind thinks way too much. And it's been in charge for so long, you think it actually is in charge. It ain't. What's in charge is the Word of God. What's in charge is the Spirit. The mind is just, shut up, mind. Get renewed to the Word of God and start thinking right. Amen. No. That does look better. We got a new projector. Amen. But God had promised to empower the disciples with the Holy Ghost to continue his ministry throughout the world. Amen. And when Christ died, and then when he arose, some of the religious people, they paid the guards that were watching the tomb, they paid them to lie to tell people that somebody came and stole the body. Because the devil does not want anybody to know that Christ really arose from the dead and now sits in heaven. Why? Because his rising from the dead is absolute proof that he is God. His rising from the dead is absolute proof that you have been, your sins have been forgiven. Amen. And that you have been welcomed back into the family of God. You have to receive that and believe that and confess that for it to actually become a reality in your life. But as far as God's concerned, it's done if you receive it. But the deal is that the devil doesn't want anybody to know that Jesus rose from the dead. You walking in the power of God is a demonstration that the power of Jesus has been transferred to you because he's still alive. The power did not die with him. Y'all out there? You are supposed to be an example of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ through example of continuing the ministry that Jesus had while he was on earth, because now you're a child of his, and that heritage and that power has been passed on to you. And you wandering around like a lost sheep is because you don't know what the Bible says, you don't believe what the Bible says, and you ain't doing what the Bible says. Because as soon as you start believing that, as soon as you recognize who you really are in Christ, and that you haven't just gotten tongues, you've been empowered, and that you can pray for people to get them healed from anything. Y'all out there? You can pray for people and get them healed from anything. Whatever was not impossible to Jesus is not impossible to you. If you will walk in that wisdom and walk in that knowledge and do it. But I'm going to tell you the truth. Most of us are going to have to spend some time with the Holy Ghost so he can get the junk out of our heads that hinders us from being totally his. Because we have stuff in our heads and stuff that we do that hinders our relationship with God. And that's why people, they like to come into a church and bow down and do a special meal and think, well, that did it, and then go and live like they have always had, because they don't know there's anything more. We are not a religious society. We are a relationship with God. And God did not save you so you could live like a mess for the rest of your life. Dear Lord. We need to get a hold of that. Well, I'm still struggling. Dear God, you could get over any struggle you have in less than a year by applying God's word, doing it, and being consistent. How long did it take you to get clean?
Once I got a hold
of God? Yeah.
A lot less time.
Huh?
I said, probably 60 days with God.
How many?
60 days with God.
60 days with God.
Before that, I tried for years.
Yeah. She used to be an addict. And she's not any longer. And did you hear what she said? Before God, she kept trying to get clean. But after she got, we've been here through the whole process. After she got saved, 60 days later, she was clean and has been clean. And now she's going to the prisons and ministering. She's doing exactly what God called her to do. Take the gospel by the power of God to the rest of the world. I'm so proud of her that she's just wanting to go, and she goes to the
The
jail and the homeless thing downtown. God has something for you to do besides sit on your rear end and complain about where you are. He has something for you to do besides have fun all the time and be so out of place with God having fun and pleasure that you don't even have a heart for anybody that's lost. Listen to me. Every one of us, our primary purpose in life is to have a heart for the lost and the knowledge to know how to go get them. The idea of us claiming to be children of God and not getting anybody saved, if you've been at work at your same job for 10 years and nobody knows you're a Christian, you're a liar. You're not a Christian. If you're a real live Christian, you don't have to go and blab everything, but when you talk to people, they'll know this is wisdom from God. You'll share from the Bible. You'll share from the power. That's what this church is here for. God didn't save me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit and keep me. John 15 says, he says, you did not call yourself, I called you. Amen. I didn't call myself to this. You didn't call yourself, God called you. The Bible says no person comes to God unless they're called. If you came to God, it's because God was working on you. And if God wanted you, He wanted you for more than just continuing to be a loser the rest of your life. He wants you to understand that everything Jesus had, the anointing, the power, you have. And the purpose is to continue the ministry of Jesus on this planet. Let a hurting and dying world know that God is risen. You talk to any other religion around the world, and the one thing they don't believe is that Christ is alive. They don't believe He's risen. They say you're just a bunch of false prophets. Well, you are if there's no demonstration. They're saying, prove it. And you should be going, the power and the anointing is here, be healed. Proof that Jesus has arisen and He's still alive and His power and His anointing are still effective on this planet through His people. Amen. It's not a small thing. It's not a minor thing to think, I got baptized in the Holy Ghost and I speak in tongues. That's not the end. That's the beginning. I got baptized in the Holy Ghost and I speak with tongues and I've been endued with power. And it's not me, it's Him. And He has endued me with power to speak to people. You don't have to go and preach, but everybody you know should know that you're a Christian. Everybody that you know, they should know when you pray, you get answers. Well, I don't get any answers. Well, it's time for you to plug in then. Because if you don't get answers to your prayers, it's not God, it's you. You're the problem. You're not sold out. You're not plugged in. Isn't this good? I'm telling you, it's time for the people of God to come alive. It's time for us to quit pretending to be Christians and to be the real deal. The world has had imposters for thousands of years. What they really want is the real deal. You're it. Amen. I know most of you. I know most of you. You're the real deal. You just don't know how real yet. Amen. See, the resurrection is the real deal. None of the other gods in the world have been resurrected. They're mostly just stones and wood. They're not even alive. No other religion on the earth can the people have a relationship with their God. You can, because your God's real. He's the real deal. Amen. And that reality should cause you to recognize what's yours. Acts chapter 4, verse 33 says this. I love this. Acts 4:33 says, watch this. It says, with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Man, I like that. He didn't say, with wimpy little crying, they gave witness to the resurrection. He says, with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ with great power. What was that power? They had healings, they had miracles, they had devils cast out. I mean, come on now. Are you going to watch TV and tell me that there aren't people around with devils in them today? My Godfries, there's a lot of people need the devil cast out of them. Now, you don't need to go run around, you're going to get the devil cast out of you. You use some wisdom, let God show you. Praise God. Y'all out? But I mean, you can't watch TV and not know there's some people with devils. Dear Lord. And they're trying to influence your kids so that they don't even know if they're a boy or a girl. Well, if that ain't the devil. Come on. Well, now don't make them mad. Dear Lord, they're going to be mad when they go to hell. Find out they believed a lie. We still love them. Amen. But what God is looking for is an army with great power that will give witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, it's funny. It's not really funny. But, you know, we preach all over Asia and South America. And I've preached a lot up in the jungles of South America and the jungles of Thailand. And what's amazing is you get people that are not Christians, and they hear the truth, and they respond to it. I mean, in Thailand, we teach in the Bible schools there, and those young people, they get done with school, and they go out to the jungles, and they start churches, little house churches. They're out telling people, they're getting people saved and going out and laying hands on people, getting them healed and stuff. In America, people don't do that because somebody might make fun of them. Or what will their parents think? We need to change. I don't know about you, but Buxton needs Jesus. North Plains needs Jesus. Bad. How many of you know Salem needs Jesus? Dear Lord, Salem really needs Jesus. Hillsboro needs Jesus. But not the imitation. Well, yeah, I go to that church. It's not about do you go to that church. Do you demonstrate God in your life? We had a fellow that came first service. He's a really nice fellow. And he kind of works with the veterans. And I'm a veteran, so I was just kind of asking him some stuff about veteran stuff. And everything everything that the veterans do has to do with when you get old and sick. I'm like, that sounds good, but I ain't getting old and sick. What do you say? I guess I will. I ain't getting old and sick. Well, you can't defy. Yeah, I can. Watch me. I ain't getting old, ain't getting sick. When it comes time for me to leave, I'll just preach my last service, have my last altar call, and flop on the pulpit. That'll be it. I ain't going to no farm. Some of y'all are trying to figure out what to do for retirement. I ain't retiring, I'm refiring. What in the world would I retire to? Not seeking Jesus? Not touching the world for Jesus? Fishing, I could go fishing. Dear Lord, you can do that for part of a day, but for the rest of your life, stop it. What about people that need God? What about people that need to be healed? Amen. Tongues is not the purpose of Pentecost. The power is the purpose of Pentecost. And what we do with that power should be evident to the world. That when we show up, the devil flees. And when he flees, the sickness goes with him. The disease goes with him. Come on. And you're God's ambassador. Are you out there? Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Romans 10, verse 9. This is how you get saved. Because this is, you and I need to be genuinely saved and not just comfortably saved. Verse 10, verse 9 says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart, watch this, did you all know this part was in there? That God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Part of salvation is believing that he's been raised from the dead. And part of the demonstration that you believe that is that his power has been transferred to you and you transfer that power to the world. Amen. That where you go, power goes. And I don't care, if you can't keep your relationships right, you need to get in the Word and do what the Bible says so that your relationships quit taking up all of your God time. Well, sickness has always been in my family. Well, you need to get in the Word, do the Word, and get sickness out of your lifetime. But you don't understand. No, you don't understand. The Word works, but you got to work it. If you don't work it, you can't keep blaming God for your sucky life. Amen. But Pastor, don't pastor me. Talk to God about it. He probably hasn't gotten to talk to you for a long time anyway. Amen. So when Jesus empowered the disciples, he empowered them to continue the work that he called, or that he was called to do. And you might say, well, yeah, you read that scripture about Philip, but he was a disciple. Yeah, but he's dead. And you have been elected to carry on that ministry. You. Well, I'm busy. Well, you need to get saved and find out what your real purpose for life is. Because whatever you're too busy with is stealing your God life. And if your God life gets stolen, there's a good chance you could drift right on by and forget God. And he's been talking to me for the last couple of years about this. He says there's a lot of people who think they're going to heaven that aren't. Because a lot of people think coming to church on Sunday is good. Well, it is good, but it's not the best. Living like a full-blown, empowered Christian all week long is what God's looking for. Amen. And I'll just tell you the truth. The heart of a real Christian is evangelism. Yes. Let me just say that one more time because I can see some of you are still stunned. The heart of a real Christian is evangelism. If evangelism is not in your heart, you're not a real Christian. Does anyone want to become a real live Christian today? Tracy wants to become a real live Christian. That's good. Amen. I got two people. Yeah, I'd like to become a real live Christian. Seven people. 12 people. Well, who will stand with me and become a real live Christian? I'm going to pray for us. Father, we repent of our lack of fervor for you and for your word. We repent of our lack of knowledge of your word. And we repent if we thought tongues was the intended and only purpose of being filled with the power of God. Father, open my eyes that I may see the intended purpose of your empowerment within me by the Holy Spirit. Father, help me to become the Christian you have intended me to be. And Lord, I will listen to you. I hear your voice, and I will obey you. Help me become that witness in Jesus' name. Amen. Got anybody in agreement with that prayer? How about we be some Christians that change Hillsboro? We've got Adopt-A-Block. What an awesome opportunity to knock on doors and pray with people. And our little Adopt-A-Block program's been going. We've had lots of healing reports from the people in the church just going and knocking on doors and ask if there's anything we can pray for you about. And our people have seen healings. Not me. I didn't go with them. Jesus didn't go with them. Well, he did. But they went. That's a good way to start. But Lord, I just pray that we'll all find avenues and opportunities to fulfill your real plan for our life. That it's not about loving ourselves. It's about loving you and loving your people. Amen. Amen. Well, praise God. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're with us. And we're all going to grow and get better at this. Amen. 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 God bless y'all. And we'll see you next week. Have a good week.